President Trump tweeted that America needs to be first in 6G. Obviously, he had no idea what he was talking about, but he was right. You've been hearing a lot about 5G. 5G is coming, 5G is now, 5G is big, 5G is scary, 5G is going to change everything, but I'm here to tell you about 6G. 5G is the wireless technology of the 2020s, and for the next 10 years, this is what's going to be all around us. But 6G is the technology of the 2030s, and people are starting to think about it now, because these technology cycles have 10-year development cycles. 3G basically started in 2000, 4G started in 2010, 5G is starting roughly now. 6G is basically calendared for 2030, which means they need to start coming up with the ideas now. And the ideas for 6G are really, really crazy. This is some amazing science fiction stuff that we need to think about, we need to get a handle on, we need to discuss in depth before it happens, all of us as a society, not just four big cell phone carriers talking about what they want for us. All of us need to be involved in this idea process. Academics are starting to get on it. I've seen a paper from professors from Virginia Tech, the University of Oulu in Finland, Beijing, coming together for ideas for 6G. There's a bigger conference coming to Northern Finland where a lot of who's who in the like extremely technical areas of the wireless industry are going to start coming up with ideas and wish lists. And the reason I keep mentioning Finland, by the way, is that Oulu, the city in Northern Finland, which I've been to, which is amazing, is kind of a center of this future network technology development. So Finland might come up again. Finland's cool. So what is 6G compared to 5G? 5G means smaller cells, higher frequencies, more bandwidth, lower latency, uses like augmented reality, virtual reality, that sort of stuff. 6G is some crazy science fiction, transhumanist Skynet stuff, because it is things that aren't possible with 5G, that aren't even possible with technologies that we know how to do yet. Okay, so here are some ideas. Multi-sensory XR applications. What is this? This is Ready Player One. This is those virtual reality suits with the helmets that cover your head with the full body haptics that give you 5-sense VR. Okay, so why can you not have 5-sense VR with 5G? Why do you need 6G to have the touching and the smelling and the tasting and the feeling and the running on the treadmill and you're in the virtual space and like it's all another reality, and what does that mean as our world crumbles around us and we're all in like little trailers because we've let the environment collapse because we're all living in the virtual world now, and that is 6G. Why do you need 6G for this? Because 6G is going to have even lower latency and is going to have something potentially called the quality of physical experience measurement, which is tuned to being able to give you these multi-sensory inputs at a very low, once again, latency, at a very high responsivity to fool your entire body into thinking it's in a different place. That could be possible with 6G. Okay, another freaky thing that they're talking about, wireless brain-to-computer interfaces. We have seen this in science fiction. This is brain implants. This is brain implants that control computers or that receive input from computers. The ethical implications of this are potentially terrifying. Okay, I'm a little terrified. Where are you getting this input from? What are your firewalls? Can you be hacked? At its most benign, this means new prosthetics, exoskeletons, virtual bodies, remote androids being operated at a distance in dangerous locations, amputees having limbs that feel completely normal. This will allow individuals to control their environments through gestures and have empathic and haptic communications, such as emotion-driven devices which can match their functions to the user's mood. Are they going to manipulate our emotions, or are our emotions going to manipulate them? Who's in control here? Okay, so let's talk about another 6G idea here. Not just autonomous cars. Fleets, swarms of massively autonomous vehicles and drones. Tiny bug-sized drones that form clouds. Clouds of drone cameras everywhere, self-organized through 6G. Complete and total surveillance. Who controls this surveillance? This is something we need to discuss. Smart surfaces and network smart environments. In the 6G world, you might have this, but it won't be that important. Everything will be smart. The furniture will be smart. The displays will be on the furniture. The displays will be printed on the furniture. The display will be printed on my arm. The display will be printed on my glasses. I mean, the display might be embedded in my brain and might be printed on my retina. At the very least, you're going to have screens in an everywhere way that you will not have with 5G. How about 3D video? You finally get the Princess Leia thing.
Help me, Obi-Wan Kenobi. You're my only hope.
We've been wanting the Princess Leia thing since like 1977, right? You want Princess Leia? That's 6G, apparently. I have a note here that just says blockchain. I guess? Blockchain? If I say it three times, does it make me money? Let's talk about how they're going to do this. Terahertz wireless frequencies. So terahertz wireless frequencies are incredibly short-range networks, higher frequency than anything that exists in the world right now because our current semiconductors cannot even vibrate or receive those frequencies. But because semiconductors can't support terahertz, terahertz frequencies are entirely free. They're entirely available. So there's massive amounts of bandwidth, which allows you to transmit massive amounts of data, but you can transmit it very short distances. So the 6G networks will be able to slide very smoothly up and down frequencies depending on the distance they need, but they will also be essentially mesh networks. Mesh instead of cellular. Cellular networks are somewhat centralized. They rely on cell sites, right? On 2G and 3G, we had these giant towers. With 4G, we kind of have these things that look like backpacks on poles in the cities. With 5G, the backpacks have gotten smaller. They're kind of about the size of paperback books. With 6G, one of the ideas is that every device broadcasts its network or some element of networking to every other device around it, and that the network becomes a series of tiny little hops, maybe only a couple of feet each, until they get to their destination or they get to access to a big fat pipe. And now if you say, oh, hey, mesh networking doesn't work because I am the only person in my room, in this room right now with a phone, remember in the 6G world, every surface might be networked. So my phone hops to my clothing, hops to the window, hops to the floor, hops to six other phones in the room. This also means billing and pricing of these networks is going to be very, very different, potentially disruptive entrants, new companies, new ideas, new models coming in to sell you this data. I have no idea what it's going to look like. We're talking about 2030. If I knew what 2030 was going to look like, I would not be on this YouTube video. I would be out making my business plan, making the money for 2030. Cellular networks are basically designed for flat planes. They're designed for a cell that is above you to broadcast down to people on the street or onto relatively flat planes of buildings. In the 6G world, though, we're going to have mesh networks where everybody is essentially a cube of network. And how do you stack these networks? How do you stack these cubes? 3D in space. Why do I keep thinking flying cars? I think we just want flying cars, right? It's really, really good that we are starting to think about 6G now, and we have to avoid thinking about it hysterically, and we have to think about it intelligently. There is a lot of hysterical nonsense going on YouTube right now about 5G. YouTube is flooded with hysterical false nonsense about 5G frying our brains or being the Illuminati or, you know, rays. You know, everybody's scared of the rays. Oh no, the rays. They're coming to fry your brain. As you can tell, my brain is already fried and we haven't even turned 5G on. The real questions here aren't rays. The questions are the ethical and political implications of who controls these networks. What do they know about you? What can they do with that information? If we're going to 6G, if we're going to self-organizing AIs and wireless implants, what does that mean for society? What does that mean for being human? What does that mean for privacy? What does that mean for autonomy? What does that mean for sentience? What is sentience in an entirely networked psychological topography? Are we going to need the three laws of robotics here? How will 6G help the Chinese government control its population? Is that something that we need to be concerned about? Do we need to be concerned about how governments will use 6G to further their ends? This is much, much more important than the, oh no, I'm allergic to the Wi-Fi. You're not allergic to the Wi-Fi. You're not allergic to the Wi-Fi, but if we do not come together as a society and think about 6G and think about even 5G and think about our politics and think about our corporate structures and think about what it means to be human and think about what it does to our attention spans and what it means that I'm staring at this phone all the time, not because of the rays, but because I'm staring at this phone all the time, that's where we'll crumble. So 6G, it's gonna be crazy. It's gonna be wild. We have 10 years. We know hardly anything about it yet. It's going to be science fiction. Stay tuned.